Welcome to Back Issues. I'm Sal.
I'm Ethan.
And I'm Ben.
Hey, Ethan's back.
Hey.
Look, everybody, Ethan's back.
You thought he died, but he didn't.
Yeah.
Or was fired.
Right?
What?
I don't know.
It's enough. It's enough out of you.
You're on thin ice, mister.
Yeah.
Pushing you with a chick.
Yeah. Which some people liked.
Yeah.
I mean, aesthetically,
most people did.
No, people were. I mean, I think it was even split. I think people were. A lot of people were like, "Where's Ethan?"
A lot of people asked.
Yeah.
Not a lot of people lamented.
Today we're doing Secret Wars. I've been wanting to do this book for a while, but we haven't had a copy in the store.
Wait, is that a good thing or a bad thing?
No, it's been selling. Like everybody, like it always sells, and it's proof positive to the theory that they had back when they invented it in 1984. In 1984, then editor-in-chief of Marvel Comics, Jim Shooter, is like, we're going to do this thing. We just had a contract with an action figure company, and so we want to launch these figures like Hasbro does with their cartoons and all these other things. Like, because I don't know if you know, I hate to burst your guys' bubble, but Thundercats and Power Rangers and Transformers were commercials for toys.
Oh,
what?
Yeah.
Because DC had just teamed up with their own company and they were making their own action
figures. Well, wait, I don't understand. They could make toys. These characters already existed. They could make toys whenever they want.
Yeah, they could.
What does the book have to do with that?
The book puts all the characters out on display in a major crossover event that kind of had never really been done before. Marvel was already like an interesting universe that was interconnected, and all these characters already visited and knew each other and were like tied in with each other. But it wasn't really until Secret Wars that they decided, like, let's do a big blockbuster blowout story with all the characters on the table.
Okay.
And so
where does this fit in, like, the history?
It fits in the 80s, early 80s. This came out in 84. So the Fantastic Four, Sue Richards is pregnant with her second child.
Is this around the time of Infinity Gauntlet?
No. Infinity Gauntlet came a couple years later. It really wasn't until like Civil War when they were like, okay, so every August, the universe is destroyed and then we rebuild it from the ground up, right?
Anyway.
So Secret Wars was written by the editor-in-chief of the time,
Jim Shooter.
Yeah, I saw
you mentioned Shooter, and I see his name right there.
Yeah, Shooter!
Shooter!
The idea with Secret Wars, besides being a commercial for the action figures they were going to start making, which they did invariably make, and they were
horrible?
They were crappy, but I loved them. Mm. And the reason why I loved them was because they were so different from any other action figures that I was used to, and they were so rare. And for a long time, that was the only line of action figures you could get certain figures. Like, they made a Constrictor figure. They made a Black Spider-Man, like Black Costume Spider-Man figure. They made a Hobgoblin figure. They made an Electro figure. By the way, all these characters, except for Black Costume Spider-Man, do not appear in Secret Wars.
Wait, what?
They just used the name to sell figures of characters that, like, never appear. And by the way, certain characters that do appear in this comic never get action figures. Like the Enchantress or She-Hulk.
So making Secret Wars was not to sell the action figures. They had a story.
Well, they made up a story.
But it didn't use the same action figures that they produced.
It allowed them to be like, look, you like Secret Wars? Buy all our toys!
And each figure came with a little comic book.
But if they really tied the comic book to the figures, then why didn't they just use the exact same character?
If they tied the figures to cartoon shows, how come we got so many different ghosts from the Ghostbuster TV series?
Yeah, how come we got so many variants of the Ninja Turtles? Detective Don ever actually appeared.
You can only fit so many characters into one movie, but with a comic book, you can do them all.
I know, but they didn't, and
they
I don't know why.
Characters that actually were in the comics.
Yeah, like Hulk, he doesn't get a figure. Like, there were so many that they didn't use, and there were so many that, like,
weird,
have really never gotten their own figure since then, and you're like, why is it that they got them then but not any other time? So weird.
How many female action figures came out of this?
Zero.
See, that doesn't surprise me.
Of course not. They didn't start making female action figures for Marvel characters, with the notable exception of the X-Men figures, and even then they were super rare, until, like, well after, like, the 90s.
Because apparently no boy wanted to play with a girl.
No,
and
even though
that was all you got. Because guess what? Your parents are buying this for you? Your parents...
They don't know.
Some girls' parents aren't going to buy you, like, Marvel figures.
No, they're not going to get you, like, Phoenix. They're going to get you Batman. But actually, they invent quite a few female characters for this book.
For this book?
But I'll get there in a minute. In addition to them selling toys, the other thing that they do was they went, okay, we've got our story. They wrote it out. They got it figured out. And then they went, what are we going to call this? Well, according to the metrics, we figured out that boys like words like secret and wars. So let's create secret war. They literally just found out that, like, 85% of kids who read comics like the word wars, and, like, you know,
that's insane.
78 people like secret.
This is the Sonic Hedgehog of comic books.
Yeah, this is like a committee that was like, how are we going to create an epic summer blockbuster? And they all worked together and they were like, well, 87% of the children who read our comics also like the words secret and wars. Well, let's put those together and create some secret wars.
What you do when you have run out of ideas.
Yeah. The story, if you can call that, of secret wars, is that there's a cosmic entity called the Beyonder.
I've heard of that.
Yeah, we talked about the Beyonder before. We talked about this book a little bit. We touched on it. But the Beyonder is this, like, interdimensional being.
Mm.
And he sees the Marvel Universe, and he sees what's going on, and he's fascinated by the concept of good versus evil. And because it's so colorfully, like, displayed in the Marvel Universe, he's like, I'll grab some samplings of good and evil, and then I'll slap together a world out of, like, existing parts from other planets and shit, stick it someplace far off in the far reaches of the universe, and then take my warriors of, like, I'll take my action figures of good and bad and put them on,
now,
like,
I get it,
opposite sides of the planet, and I'll give them access to, like, some random technology and some weapons and stuff, and we'll see who wins. And the Beyonder appears before everybody and says, slay your enemies and all your desires shall be yours. If you win, you all get your greatest wish. Which, by the way, is kind of flimsy, and, like, we don't even get to see much of, like, their greatest wishes or anything like that. The only wish we ever see granted is the things.
I was going to say, I assume they don't really kill that many people, because you can't kill them.
Oh, no, they don't kill anybody.
They can't come back.
Well, they kill... Okay. They kill no one, and they kill everyone.
Oh, God.
So, here's the sampling of the heroes.
Okay.
You got the X-Men, you got the Avengers, and you got the Fantastic Four, and a couple of other characters.
Like this.
That girl is Captain Marvel.
Oh.
That girl is the Wasp. You got Captain America, Storm, Reed Richards, the Hulk.
It's so funny for the W that,
yeah,
I thought was just a lapel.
No, it stands for Wasp. Professor X, Wolverine, Thor, The Thing, Spider-Man, Rogue, who's new to the X-Men, by the way.
Oh.
She had been a bad guy and then just joined the X-Men.
Magneto,
Iron Man, who is played by Jim Rhodes at the time.
Oh.
Beyonder doesn't understand the difference between what Professor X is doing and what Magneto's doing.
Oh.
And so he puts them on the same side.
Interesting.
And everyone here is like, what's Magneto doing here? And Magneto's like, clearly the Beyonder seems to think that we're not too different. And everyone's like, oh, we're different, all right. Oh, no, we're different. I don't like being challenged.
The little dragon guy.
And Lockheed the Dragon.
All right, then.
What?
All right.
You know, Lockheed.
In X-Men, the character Kitty Pryde, who was having a relationship with Colossus at the time, Shadowcat, she had, like, a dragon, like a pet dragon named Lockheed.
Was it a mutant?
No, it was just a dragon. Sue Storm was pregnant, so she couldn't come. It also brought down the average of women.
I guess they didn't want to have a pregnant lady.
They thought it would be irresponsible.
Yeah.
Throughout the book, by the way, Reed Richards is like, my pregnant wife is back at home and I'm so worried about her. So
she's home. She's fine.
I know. Like, it's more like he can't imagine how she'll survive without him.
I am, of course, the Hulk. And Hulk is with it now? He's not...
At this point, Bruce Banner is kind of in control, but okay. Throughout the story, Bruce Banner starts getting pushed onto the back burner, and the Hulk starts to come out, and so everyone's like, oh, shit.
Oh, man.
The villains on this team...
Wait, they put Galactus in with the villains?
They put Galactus in with the villains.
You can't fight him?
No.
And he's also not of Earth.
No, and you can't fight him. Like, he's just there, and he's like... And he does that the whole book, just like, until he does it. Well, then he goes... They put together the planet, right? And then he goes, well, I guess I'll get to work eating the planet, then.
So the Beyonder looks at Earth, and he says,
yeah,
look at these forces of good and evil.
Right.
I'm going to grab them. I'm going to bring them to a planet where they can fight each other.
Yeah.
And, like, I'll tell them whoever wins can get their wildest desires. Why don't you just do that on Earth? You already have everyone on a planet, all the people he thought.
Well, all the other people will interfere.
Yeah.
He wants to make it balanced.
Yeah. He also is like...
What? What? People can't be involved in this?
Well, no, they...
Look at Hawkeye. Hawkeye's not a mutant.
Well, people would, like...
He's a hero. He's a member of the Avengers.
Like, regular people who aren't, like, costumed heroes would, like, side with the heroes against the villains.
That's pre-9/11 talk. Post-9/11 talk is like, well, you could get firemen and policemen and paramedics. They're heroes, too.
Those are also heroes.
And,
that's true.
And veterinarians.
All right, this is the rundown of the bad guys.
Roster.
We got the villains roster, yeah. The rogues gallery, if you will. We got the Enchantress, who's like female Loki. She's a Thor villain.
Okay.
She's also in love with Thor.
Oh.
And throughout the book, like, tries to just get Thor to, like, bang her and leave.
Kind of like a lot of people are saying about Loki nowadays.
Yeah.
Which is creepy.
It is. Got Ultron 8, who's a better father than you'll ever be. Crusher Creel, a.k.a. the Absorbing Man, who made an appearance on a certain Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. show recently.
SpongeBob?
Sponge Man, where?
he's absorbing man.
Oh, yeah.
Or Bounty Man.
No, he absorbs the properties of anything he touches. He's like the T-1000, kind of. Like,
which episode of S.H.I.E.L.D. was that? I don't even remember.
The first episode of the new season.
Oh, I didn't even know it started.
Yeah. There's also the Wrecking Crew, who are also kind of like Avengers / Thor villains. They're lame.
Yeah, they're like wrestlers.
Never even heard of them.
That's because they're lame. The Wrecking Crew are just literally a team of bad guys who can pick up heavy objects and they break shit.
All right, who's this guy?
That's the Molecule Man. His power is he can control molecules.
Oh. How do you fight him?
Right? That's what Dr. Doom basically says to him. He's like, well, you're the most powerful being in existence.
You just rip apart anybody who opposes you.
Molecule Man is...
like Dr. Manhattan.
He is Dr. Manhattan.
Yes, he is Dr. Manhattan.
And the writer is savvy enough to know this, but puts him on the team anyway, because he's a bad guy.
Uh-huh.
But Molecule Man is also trying to reform himself at this point. Okay. He's also incredibly insecure and has confidence issues.
Oh.
So, like... He's like, no, I shouldn't be here, and I shouldn't be doing anything. My therapist says that I really shouldn't be using my powers. So anyway...
Well, what happened to Molecule Man? I've never heard of him.
Well, he probably had some horrifying
experience. Yeah, he's still around.
Or he's just like, he accidentally atomized a kid, and he's like, oh god, I'm sorry.
Oh no,
I'll put him back together. It's even worse.
I don't know how to put together humans. Just because I am the Molecule Man and can control molecules, I mean, I'm magic.
He's seen terrible things now, so he's just like, I gotta go see a doctor.
Actually, Molecule Man actually appears in this one, New Avengers. It's like set 8 months in the future, like Future's End, only more interesting.
Well, isn't Future's End like way in the future?
It's like 5 years in the future.
Yeah.
See? There he is.
Oh, he's... controlling molecules, I guess.
Yeah. So Beyonder actually winds up destroying a galaxy and then grabbing random parts of it and putting together a planet.
He destroys an entire galaxy.
To display his power.
To produce one planet.
Well, it's so that you can have a planet with many different properties, sort of like a Mario world.
So I'm going to destroy this entire galaxy, and then I'm going to take, like, 1/1,000,000,000 of it
yep.
and put it into a planet.
Yeah.
No, look, I didn't destroy the whole galaxy. I just destroyed the planets in the galaxy.
He destroys the
but
galaxy.
But then what does it matter?
Look, it's gone. The spiral. Like, by the way...
There's nothing left.
Yeah. What he winds up doing is he actually winds up, like, grabbing, like, random pockets of, like, other civilizations.
Oh.
And, like, so they're there, too?
Oh, jeez.
Yeah.
That
by the way...
all fucked up. How do you do that with atmosphere?
He creates an atmosphere around the planet.
Yeah, but for that everyone can breathe?
Yeah.
He only takes civilizations that breathe oxygen.
Of course, the villains all start fighting each other immediately. Ultron's like, I don't work with humans at all! I hate all living beings! And so he, like, loses his shit. By the way, at this point, Ultron's also made of adamantium, so he's, like, nigh invincible.
Oh, jeez.
And then, of course, that's when Dr. Doom's like, you Molecule Man! You could, like, unmake Ultron!
Mm.
And so all he winds up doing is, like, pushing Ultron into Galactus, and then, like, Galactus winds up, like, pulling him up to look at him, and Ultron starts, like, screaming at him, and then he just, like, takes whatever is making Ultron alive and just, like, absorbs it.
Oh, wow.
That's enough. And then Galactus is like, I'm gonna go. I've had enough. And so he leaves, and then the Beyonder kicks his ass, and then Galactus is, like, laid out for most of the book. And then he gets up, and he's like, fuck this, I'm gonna eat the planet.
Good.
That's what I do.
And then the heroes start fighting, and the reason why they start fighting is because immediately You know, everyone's like, hey, so Magneto, you gotta go, because you're a bad guy, and we don't want to deal with you.
Right.
And the X-Men go, well, hold on a second here. Like, maybe you don't like Magneto because he's a mutant.
Oh, God.
Really?
Yep. So Magneto goes, fuck you guys, and he leaves. And the heroes, for the most part, pretty much go like, all right, let's figure out how to get home. We're not playing this game. Mm-hmm. I'm just gonna leave. And then, like, the villains attack, and they have a couple of fights. There's several battles.
Now, for someone to win, does it have to be one person or just one team?
The team has to win.
Okay,
and do they have to murder their opponents, or...?
They have to defeat their opponents.
That sounds kind of flimsy.
I don't know what that means, because they never kill their opponents.
Right.
Well, I mean, it's like calling uncle or tapping out twice.
Yeah.
It's like, I'm defeated.
You acknowledge that you've been beaten.
I have been defeated. Well done. Enjoy your prize, whatever it might be.
It's a packet of peanuts.
There's a great moment in here. There's a lot of, like, fun little moments in here. But, like, it's a great one where, like, Thor is just like, I gotta get out for a minute. And he just leaves the base, and he just starts, like, making it rain.
What's the secret?
The secret is that they're doing this, like, where they all went and what they're all up to. Because then they come home, and they're like, let's not talk about what happened.
Oh.
Why?
Because it was lame and dumb.
It really didn't make any sense. I thought you liked this.
I love it. It's one of my favorite, like, Marvel crossovers, because it's just unabashedly, like, it's just, let's watch all these characters fight and do stuff. You watch Captain America lead all the superheroes to a big fight against the villains. You watch, like, Spider-Man beat all the X-Men.
Really?
Yep.
Nice.
He's, like, crawling around, and he, like, winds up catching up with the X-Men, who have found their own little corner of the hero base and, like, sectioned it off and put, like, a No Humans Allowed sign on the front.
Does it literally say No Humans
Allowed? No, I'm just saying, like, it's basically like that. And they're all, like, talking about what they should do and how, like, the heroes never trust them, even though they've just sequestered themselves in a corner of the room. And then they're like, okay, so Magneto found his own base. We should go join Magneto. A genocidal madman who arguably might have kidnapped the Wasp during a confusing moment in the earlier story.
What?
And, like, during that story where, like, Wasp might be kidnapped by Magneto, like, there's a storm going on outside, and, like, so Wasp can't leave, but she's also, like, kind of there willingly. It's not really quite clear, but she's not, like, in shackles or anything.
Mm.
Magneto's like, well, you know, there's wine, and there's, like, plenty of food if you want to, like, hang out with me. And she's like, get away from me. Like, you're gross. And he's like, am I gross or am I intriguing? And then they start making out, and you're like,
what?
What is happening? What is happening?
Was there any prior claim that Wasp was interested in Magneto?
No, it's just that Wasp is just, like, a fickle chick who's like, well, I'm alone with this guy. I guess I'll hook up with him.
Okay.
Anyway, Spider-Man's crawling around the base, and he hears the X-Men, like, conspiring to join Magneto, and he's like, nah, I'm gonna call bullshit on that, and he just, like, kicks their ass, and everyone on the team, at some point or another, goes, he is so awesome! Like,
well, how does he beat Professor X?
Oh, he doesn't. Like, well, he pushes Professor X out of his chair. He's like, get out of here! Professor X, oh!
That's insane!
I know! And then Spider-Man escapes, he runs to Reed Richards, and he's like, Richards, I have to tell you something! And Richards is like, what? And he's like, I don't remember. and then Professor X goes like, whoo! Good thing I came too just in time to rape someone's mind. I don't like to do it, but it's important that I do
that.
If
I'm about to be embarrassed, it's pretty important.
Exactly. So, yeah.
Wow.
It's fucking weird. So,
So Spider-Man just fights them and then leaves?
Yeah.
What was the point of that?
Because then you got to see Spider-Man fight the X-Men. Isn't that
cool? I thought he was going to stop them from joining Magneto.
No, he doesn't. Doctor Doom winds up, like, using his access at what he calls, I think, Doom Base to immediately, like, transport people from Earth to the base.
Oh.
So, like, because he wants to get Molecule Man to, like, help him out, and Molecule Man keeps, like, complaining that, like, there's no chicks and that he's, like, lonely. So, like, Dr. Doom grabs these two chicks who are, like, friends, I guess, and they're, like, not very good people, and he, like, uses the technology in Doombase to give them powers.
My question is, who are they?
They're nobody.
How did they get there?
He transports them
from Earth.
From Earth. He uses the technology.
Why does he just go home?
Because he's like, no, I want to steal the power of the Beyonder. He's like, I can't leave until I've stolen the power of the Beyonder.
Why
I could be a god.
Go home.
Because nobody else knows that he's doing that.
So, does he intentionally get
two chicks with like huge boobs, or
no, they're just drawn that way.
No, he gets one chick with huge boobs.
Oh, I didn't.
And one
see
chick
the other
is
one.
Flat, and then once they're super powered,
then they both have huge boobs. Yes,
which is dumb.
Yeah, Volcana is the first one. She can turn into fire, and I think the other one's called Titania.
So wait, he can just make superheroes?
With the technology that's available to him at Doombase on Battleworld, yeah.
Why doesn't he just make himself even more powerful?
Because he already believes he is the most powerful.
I mean, he's pretty powerful. Yeah,
he's like, I've already...
Dr. Doom's pretty that area. Yeah,
exactly.
And, what does Titania do?
Titania's just really strong.
Oh. It looks like she shoots a blast.
No, that's Volcana. She, like, melts a big pile of scrap, and then Titania lifts it.
Oh.
And then she tries to, like, fight Absorbing Man. He's like, get away.
This Molecule Man impressed by them?
Oh, he's like, falls for Volcana. And she, like, really falls for him. So, like, the two of them become kind of an
idol. You don't want to do that. That's going to burn.
No, he can just control the molecules. And also, she can turn it off. It's not like a curse. She can actually, like, control it.
Unless she gets excited.
Probably. So, Dr. Doom coerces the Molecule Man into taking a huge chunk of Earth and just throwing it at the heroes.
Oh.
And, like, and when I say a huge chunk of Earth, I mean, like...
this like he dropped the U.S.
like a
on
continent
them.
On
yeah,
them.
He dropped yeah. a continent on them. And the Hulk holds it up.
No!
Because he's so fucking...
No!
Yeah. This is arguably the coolest moment of the Hulk ever. People love that moment.
The more you hurt him, the stronger he gets. Well,
the matter
you drop
gets,
a huge thing on him...
He's gonna be pretty pissed.
Yeah.
So he's super strong. And, like, by the way, like, it's not like he holds the whole damn thing up. He holds up, like, the area around everybody.
Right.
So, like, it creates, like, a pocket, and he's holding up, like, the mountain from falling, but, like, you know, the rest
of the world crumbles around them.
Yeah.
Okay, so I thought he was holding up the whole thing, like, just like, no, I got this.
Yeah, he creates,
like a little well for them.
Like, I mean, that's still a huge amount of weight.
Oh, yeah.
Still, like, the weight of all that rock above him.
Yeah, Reed Richards builds a machine that, like, plows them out of it, and then they find this, like, ancient culture of people who are also, like, healers.
Mm.
And they heal everybody.
Good thing they didn't get crushed by that continent.
I know.
They're thriller cats.
Yeah, they're like Neytiri and the fucking...
Like the Galactus is just standing on a mountain over there.
Yeah, it's just like... Yep. I really have a respect for the book because at least they're not like, time to fight! And even right. The villains, like, the villains can barely hold it together long enough to launch a fight. And even when they do, like, there's infighting, there's, like, backstabbing, they're just typical villains.
That's kind of cool.
And it's fun to see.
Yeah.
So, Johnny Storm the Human Torch winds up falling in love with one of the healers.
The Neytiri?
Yeah. And then, like, Colossus gets healed by that girl. And then he falls in love with her. And they don't fight or anything. The Human Torch just kind of stops.
What was the point of setting all that up if they're not going to fight?
I don't know. But, like, for whatever reason, Johnny Storm falls in love with her. Like, falls in love with her.
Right.
And then somebody gets hurt. Like, I think Reed gets hurt. And, like, the chick is like, hey, Johnny, what's going on? And he's like, get away! My friends are hurt. I gotta go. And she's like, what? And then, like, she heals Colossus, and Colossus loses every... Like, he's just like, I'm in love with you! And he, like... By the way, he was, like, dating Shadowcat at home, and he's like,
Oh, my God.
I'm gonna make it with this alien babe.
Look, I'm on a different world. Yeah. Different world, different rules.
Exactly. What happens on Battle World stays on Battle World. Okay? So...
Such a soap opera.
And I mention that only because it's a key plot point in what and how everything turns out.
You're so, kidding sure. me.
I know, yeah.
Why not?
So the villains launch another siege on
why
the heroes.
Why does Doom only create two?
Why not, like, a dozen? I don't know.
And why do they agree to fight for him?
Again.
Because he made them super powerful. Once you make someone super powerful, they owe you their allegiance.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah. So the other thing
maybe
that's
they were not Varians. We don't know that.
They're not. So the other thing that happens in this book, which is neat, is that... Ben Grimm, a.k.a. The Thing,
mm-hmm.
suddenly all the rocks go away. And he's Ben Grimm.
Oh. Weird.
Yeah. And he's like, what's going on? And then he's just Ben Grimm. And they're like, well, you're your normal now, so you're useless. Thanks
so we can't use
we
you.
We can't use you, bye.
Thanks, Beyonder.
And, like, later on in the story, like, he just starts switching back and forth. Like, he can turn... It's like a power he has now.
Oh.
And he's like, oh, my God, like, I can be The Thing, but I can also, like, have sex with people, like... Or, you know, whatever, wear normal clothes that aren't stretchy. Like, this is great.
It's what he's always wanted.
Yeah. It's always wanted.
Yeah.
You see what's going on here?
Yes.
Did he defeat his enemy?
Did he? It's weird.
What?
Well, it's more like the planet has energy that, like, can be used to grant your desires.
Oh.
Like, you can draw from the planet. It's not really more Beyonder bestowing the gift as it is, like, the Beyonder imbued the planet with, like, things you might need in your pursuit and whatever. It's kind of hazy and unclear.
So Johnny Storm needed to fall in love with a chick and then immediately not fall in love
Well, that was just a thing that they put in.
Well, he didn't harness it right, like, like Thing did.
Yeah. There's this character named Julia Carpenter, a.k.a. Spider-Woman 2, and she appears, and that's her first appearance, is this Spider-Woman. The second Spider-Woman. Not the Spider-Woman that's, like, on the Avengers and has, like, the red suit.
Wait!
Right.
Where is the Beyonder? What does he look like? Is he up in space?
He's up in space, and he's, like, he looks like a crack in space-time. He's, like, light that comes out of a crack in space itself.
So he's God. Dr. Doom goes to try to beat a crack in space.
Yes.
A wrinkle in time.
If you will.
I guess it doesn't work.
No, he gets his ass kicked again.
Wait. He doesn't wear the Venom costume?
This is the origin of the Venom costume.
Everyone liked this costume, so they made a symbiote so that he could have this costume back.
Okay. You just said a lot of things that don't make any sense, so I'm gonna take it from the top. Here's where... Because I was going to get to that, but you, like, jumped to it for no reason.
Well, you turn to the page.
That's what I
was like, you have to explain where it came from. It doesn't make any sense unless I explain it.
I thought you were saying he just wanted a black costume, so he, like, made one.
No! No,
it like, oh,
if
I
only
like her
were
costume.
That easy.
Oh. I thought that's what it, that
it's,
thought
it's
that's
not what you were saying. No, yeah. Well, it looks identical to her costume.
Right.
Yeah.
But it wasn't he that chose that.
Well, we don't know, because here's the idea. Like, after this fight with the supervillains, another fight with the supervillains, the heroes win.
Okay.
Okay? And then the fight is so intense that a lot of the heroes, like, lose part of their costume or they get torn and shit. And they find this, like, machine that will repair their costumes for them. So, like, Thor's helmet is, like, lost in battle. And then he, like, thinks of it and it appears. And so Spider-Man's like, hey, great. Like, maybe I can, like, fix up my costume. Like, it's all torn up and shit. And so they're like, it's in there. So Spider-Man goes into this room full of alien technology. He's like, I guess it's this one? And then he thinks about it, and then this black ball lands out of nothing. And then he picks it up, and it becomes the costume.
And that's where the symbiote comes from?
Yeah, it's not a costume maker. It's just a machine that the symbiote was hiding in. But it knows that he wanted, like, a new costume, or at least it knew that he wanted a costume, so it created that, and he says, that's weird, it looks like it looks like Spider-Woman's costume. I guess I was inspired by her look.
Oh. And then my thoughts went into this machine.
Yep. Like, I assumed that the machine read my thoughts, and it, like, thought I wanted to look more like that new Spider-Woman, so I guess it gave me this costume. Oh, it also responds to my thoughts, and it, like, changes into other outfits, and even though my web shooters are gone, because Reed Richards needed them to build his machine to bore us out of that mountain, I can shoot webs again.
Oh.
So, like, later, like, at the end of the book...
How is his spider sense not going off?
Not hurting
it does actually go off. Why is it making my spider sense tingle? But later on...
Oh, thank God.
The alien symbiote, which, of course, this is revealed to be the origin of the Venom costume, its proximity and biological connection with Spider-Man for so long...
Turn off.
Allows it to not respond to the spider sense.
All right. Freedom.
The other thing that we never got a chance to talk about, because Iron Man is a D-list hero during this time, is that Tony Stark isn't in the Iron Man costume, but nobody knows that. It's actually Jim Rhodes, a.k.a. Future War Machine, that's in the Iron Man costume.
Right.
And he also is like, I don't trust these white people. Like, if they knew that I was Jim Rhodes and not their trusted friend, like, I bet they would treat me differently.
I agree with that.
Does he hang out with, like, Storm now?
He actually tries to hook up with Captain Marvel, who's also African American.
Right.
Look, we don't want to cross any crazy boundaries.
No.
Here.
Yeah, which is like, what?
So he never, like, reveals and says, like, hi, I'm Jim Rhodes. I'm a very good friend of Tony Stark's.
Yeah.
He let me have this suit.
I'm not sure if actually Tony Stark's secret identity is...
Oh, known yet?
Known yet. So
Yeah. That would be a really good reason why he doesn't take off the costume the whole goddamn time.
Yeah, yes. He's like, I gotta keep this.
Exactly.
Ugh, going to the bathroom must suck.
What is happening on these pages? So skeletons craziness? And some kind of machine?
Galactus is going to, like, take the Beyonder's power. And then Dr. Doom, who's invented another machine, siphons it through Galactus and then takes the power.
Oh. And puts it in himself?
In himself, yes.
What is the power?
I like how he doesn't glow or anything.
The power is, like, everything. Like, he can do anything.
Oh.
So, like, he winds up, like, taking the Beyonder's power, and then he's like, that's it. I win. I'm God now.
I mean, that's true.
Yeah. I mean, like, and then he uses...
So he built a machine that can steal the power of a god.
Yes.
Deus ex machina.
It's, yeah, it's well, literally a god machine.
That's a comment about technology right there.
Yeah, that's fucking Dr. Doom.
I like the fact that we get to see parts of his face.
Oh, we see his whole face.
He looks like Spider-Man.
He looks like a white guy with brown hair.
Wait, why does he become good? Right, because he takes
He's not
all
good.
The power?
No, he's like, I'm good. I don't need to be I'm okay. Dr. Doom anymore. Like,
right. He doesn't like, need whatever. A mask.
Because he's also like a douche and a megalomaniac. Hulk starts acting funny. Like, he's being possessed by something. And then it goes away. And it's just laying the seed for the idea that, like, the Beyonder survived his battle with Dr. Doom. And he's, like, just this ball of energy. But he can't quite, like, constitute himself yet. And he doesn't know if he would survive another battle with Dr. Doom with all of his power. So he starts, like, possessing people and, like, getting closer to Doom.
Oh.
And he's waiting for a moment when Doom is at his weakest so he can strike and take his power back.
Okay.
I also forgot to mention that Claw is here because he's, like, not important.
I don't know what that is.
Claw is a villain who has the ability to control sound waves and make them into, like, concussive blasts and stuff.
Okay.
And, he becomes Dr. Doom's, like, loyal servant. He becomes, like, like Smeagol.
So Doom still has all the power.
Right? Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
So then Dr. Doom's like, okay, fuck these heroes. And he just strikes at them with a bolt from the blue. That's what they call it.
Oh.
And he kills all of them.
Wow.
How great is that?
Well, because the idea was, Doom's like, I'm a god, leave me alone, I'm going. And they're like, we can't let Doom keep this power. We can't let Doom be a god. We have to stop him. Have we all agreed? And they're all like, yes, we all agree. And then Doom kills them all.
Oh.
Because he can see everything. He's like, no.
Right.
Like, what the hell's wrong with you? So then it's established that, like, Claw has been possessed by the Beyonder.
Oh.
And he starts saying, like, you know, well, like, maybe the heroes did survive. Like, maybe they made it. And Doom's like, no, it's not possible. Like, how could it be possible? And Claw's like, well, I have a theory, and so I'll show you using my sound powers. I'll, like, use my sound powers to, like, create images, and I'll show you this, and I'll draw the comic for you to show you where it goes.
Mm-hmm.
So Claw creates this scenario in which, like, the healer chick that fell in love with Colossus, she is, like, looking for them, and she happens upon their bodies, and she finds the body of Colossus, who had become metal at the last second, and so his body is less damaged than everybody else's, and then she uses her healing powers, and she pours her, like, life essence into Colossus, thereby resurrecting Colossus, but she dies in the process, and it's all sad. Then, Colossus goes to Reed Richards, who's also elastic, and so he's, like, not going to be as damaged as everybody else.
From a goddamn bolt
from
the
blue. Yeah. So then he puts Reed Richards into a healing machine, and then he makes Reed Richards survive, and then Reed Richards uses his intelligence and his stretchy powers to, like, put all the bodies into their own healing chambers, and then he and Colossus work together to heal all the heroes, and so they're on their way here right now. And Doom's like, no, that can't be possible! And it, like, but you fool, because you've shown me this, and you've introduced the doubt into my mind, the godlike powers within me might actually make it happen! And he's like, no, it's not possible. And then Mjolnir shows up. And he's like, damn it!
Bizarre.
So then, like, he's like, I can't control the power! And so, like, Claw's like, wait, like, I'll slay your enemies for me, just give me some of your power. So he gives him a bunch of his Beyonder power, thereby allowing the Beyonder to, like, constitute himself. But Claw's also kind of still captaining the ship, so Claw creates these, like, monsters that are weirdly drawn to fight this ridiculous double page splash of random monsters.
Those look so stupid.
Yeah.
Especially that one.
And then, like, Captain America fights Doom, but Doom keeps killing him, but because he had the doubt that they could be dead for long, they keep coming back. It's like a metaphor for Marvel. I kill you, but I don't believe you're really dead, so they come back to life. If this was what they used to explain how Marvel characters come back to life, that, like, there's a, like, the Beyonder power, like, is imbued in all the heroes that went to the Beyonder world, and so, like, that would be fucking amazing. I'm sure that is not anything they would ever do, but I love the idea that, like, I killed you. He atomizes him, and he's like, but I can't believe that you're actually dead. And so they keep coming back. And then eventually he's just overwhelmed by the power, and then the Beyonder jumps out of Claw, takes the power back, and then puts Dr. Doom back in his place where his, like, face is all mangled, and then seemingly atomizes Claw and Dr. Doom, but in reality, like, teleports them back to Earth.
Does Captain America remember being atomized over and over again?
I don't know. I bet he does.
Well, his shield is wrecked.
Well, the shield got wrecked, yeah, from the bolt from the blue. That's the thing that didn't get fixed. But
for some reason,
the villains are defeated. Dr. Doom is gone. And, you know, the healer chick dies, but who cares? And it's convenient for Colossus, because now he can go back to his actual girlfriend.
Right. Like nothing happened.
Yeah, and hopefully none of these guys are fucking douchebags and are gonna narc
hey,
on him.
Guess what happened while we were off
world? Oh my god, yeah. Kitty.
You and your dragons are coming to my
X-Nay.
Place. I thought she was there with the dragon.
No, just the dragon came.
Oh, just the dragon
How came. Weird is that?
Yeah, no.
That's freaking weird. Really
That's like
weird.
All the superheroes got to go, and this person's dog.
Yeah. All these, like, random things that people like or want start to happen, and so they're like, oh, I think this is actually, like, a byproduct of having won the battle.
Oh.
So, like, Captain America's like, oh, maybe if, like, that's the case, he grabs his shield with all the broken pieces, and he puts them on a table, and he just goes, and then the shield's back, and he's like, yay!
Oh, my God.
And so...
Does Spider-Man get Uncle Ben back?
Nope. What would he want, right? Like, at this point, like, he's banging Mary Jane. The only thing that he might want is, like, Gwen Stacy or Uncle Ben to survive, and, like, they would only, like, what, they would show up on Battleworld, and he'd be like, so, anyway, this is my uncle, this is my ex-girlfriend. I really wanted them not to be dead, so, you know. So, anyway, Colossus is like, I'm sad, the alien woman I love is dead, I'm gonna stay here on Battleworld. You guys go on without me. Oh, by the way, Professor X can walk. Because that's all he's always wanted.
Right.
And it's hilarious because, like, Storm's the head of the X-Men at this point. They kind of, like, changed up a little bit. And so Storm is, like, the leader of the X-Men. And so she's like, I'm looking forward to helping... I'm looking forward to having you on my team, Professor X. And Professor X is like, well, now Storm must not be hasty. Now that I can walk, maybe I might want to take a more active role in the X-Men. And she's like, you play a dangerous game, Professor. And you're like, what is happening?
What?
Reed Richards using kind of, like, the powers of what he wants, plus the alien tech, create teleporters. Because also there's no villains attacking right now, so there's like a minute to think.
Are they still on the Denver Rock?
No, the Denver Rock, the villains wind up going back home because the
villains were on the Denver
just
Rock.
The villain. No, the villains are like, Doom took the Beyonder's powers. Let's get the shit out of here.
Okay, I see now.
So they leave.
Okay.
So the heroes, like, teleport themselves out of here.
Lockheed gets what it wants. And it's
another dragon!
Yeah. Even Lockheed gets what it wants.
Yep.
Yeah.
Except for Spider-Man. He gets a costume that never tears and also becomes his greatest villain.
That he never asks for. Yeah, that beats the shit out of him.
Except that happened before.
And tries to eat him.
It's really weird. So, Reed Richards winds up, like, sending everyone back, but in, like, teams. Like, in groups of, like, who's they're affiliated with.
So you can go back to your own book.
Yeah. It's actually, I like the Spider-Man line where Reed's like, okay, everybody, I'm going to explain how this works. And Spider-Man goes, phooey, just send us home, Reed. We don't care how your machine works. Okay. He's the readers.
Yep.
So,
awesome.
Professor X winds up convincing Colossus to go with them.
Okay.
Like, don't stay here.
Don't stay here. All right, I guess I'll stay here.
You know, I do have a girlfriend back home. She'd probably be really upset if I stayed.
And she's alive.
Yeah. So, Lockheed's dragon, like, Lockheed's mate, jumps into the teleporting machine, and, like, it makes an explosion, but that doesn't matter.
It doesn't matter?
It's just, it's a weird plot point where they're like, what happened? Oh, no, I don't know. But no one
better buy the next issue of X-Men.
Yeah, but nobody ever picks it up. Like, nobody cares. So then She-Hulk shows up, and she's like, hey, Avengers, you can go without me. I used the costume machine and made myself a Fantastic Four costume. And they're like, the fuck? And Thing is like, I theorize that I won't be able to change back to Ben Grimm if I go home. So I'm going to stay here, I'm going to keep the teleporting machine, and I'm just going to get acquainted with the fact that, like, I'm probably not going to be myself if I ever go home again. So, like, I just want to be here, and, like, there's food and machinery and indoor plumbing and stuff.
Okay.
So, like,
She-Hulk's going to be the new...
But you need a muscle person, so right. She-Hulk joins the Fantastic Four.
Oh.
That is cool.
It is cool, and she's a fun character.
I really thought you were going to be like, and this is a fun book, and it's great.
Secret Wars 2?
No, Secret Wars.
Secret Wars is fun!
Yeah, you look, like a lot of, clearly if you just like Secret Wars.
I do enjoy it. It's just also insanely dumb. It's like any episode of Thundercats.
Right. Yeah.
I have a huge amount of nostalgia for it, but if you fucking sit down and watch it, it's really dumb.
You know what the secret is? The secret is that Colossus made time.
Yeah!
Yeah. With that random chick.
The secret is...
And we're keeping it for Kitty Pryde.
Yeah, don't let her know that I banged this alien chick that died for me. Yep. Loved me so much, she died to save me. Anyway, Secret Wars...
Does that ever come up?
That's the secret struggle.
If it does, I've never seen it. I hope it does. I would love to know if it did ever come up. Kitty's like, yeah, why don't you go bang an alien broad and have her kill herself for you, fucking jackass? Like, when they do wind up breaking up. Yeah, he goes, yeah.
Logan told me. Yeah.
Can you imagine if Colossus tried to, like, do that, like, boyfriend thing? I read your text message. Who's Cynthia?
What?
She's a chick I work with. Who cares?
She just healed me.
I am so hurt that you look through my phone. You look through my texts. Like, the real question is, how did you know my lock screen key combination?
That is a violation of trust.
Yeah.
I don't even know who you are.
I need to go. I just need to go for a little while.
I'm not even mad. I'm just disappointed. That you would do that, that you would breach that trust.
But I think I can find it in my heart to forgive you
if we never bring it up again.
I think we should learn a lesson about forgiveness.
You know what? In fact, I'll apologize too. I feel like we're both responsible for what you did and what I didn't do. What's that? Professor X is calling me. Magneto is attacking the city.
He just runs through a wall.
Yeah.
Go. I imagine that's how Colossus leaves any situation.
What?
What?
Yeah.
Goosh.
What's that?
Goosh.
What's that, Professor?
Goosh.
Yep. That's the secret of Secret Wars.
Okay, guys. Never embarrass Colossus, because he'll just bust a hole in your wall.
It's the goddamn Kool-Aid Man.
Exactly. No, it's fine, Colossus. It's okay.
No, it's okay.
I have to run away.
No, I can't.
It's Magneto. No, it's not Magneto. Stop. It's fine. It's okay. You won't bring it up.
Go.
Oh, well, there goes my restoration. Secret Wars by Jim Shooter. It's fun. You know what? You would never finish reading this.
Yeah.
I would be like, you should read it.
I'd get through issue one. I'd be like, that's enough.
Well, we've had a good ride.
Sal explained it.
A classic from Marvel Comics. A classic from my own collection. Love this book. Kind of. Thanks a lot for watching, everybody. I'm Sal.
I'm Ethan.
And I'm Ben.
This was a ridiculous episode of Back Issues. Oh, yeah, and click the annotation to see every episode of Back Issues we've ever done.
Right.
Bye.
So.